Bob Ryan is back from Transy. It's Transy, Jeff Goodman, I was told. Transy, which is somewhere in Kentucky.
I drove by there in the preseason. It's right in Lexington, right, Bob? Like, I drove downtown Lexington. It's right there.
Stone stuff from downtown. It's a nice little neighborhood. It's a nice compact campus. Campusy. I mean, it just, you know, you want a picture of a college campus, take a picture of Transy. And that's what it's called. Transy, everybody can, even within and without the community, it's known as Transy, Transylvania University, which is the oldest university west of the Alleghenies, you know, founded in 1780, got a very interesting history, got an amazing collection of alumni, of politicians.
How's the team, though? But, Bob, how's the team?
So-so. They were 8-5 when I saw them. They lost to the first-place team in the Heartland Conference, Hanover. They were behind 17-1 to start, and they dug themselves out of the hole, and I got it down to about.
Did you go on the court and give like an inspirational speech to them when they were down 17-1?
No, I was the color man on the streaming broadcast. However,
we got to get a hold of that. We got to get a hold of that,
especially when they were down 17-1, right?
Yeah, like,
what was Bob saying then?
Well, you know, I was trying to be nice, you know, it's a long game, you know, that game ain't over.
Yes,
I don't know.
That's right.
Hey, Jim, Bob, this was Jim 203.
Jim 203, Jeff.
Here we go. He counts D2s and NAIAs.
Of course I do.
It doesn't matter.
It's a venue for college basketball. That's
I love it.
Two new ones this year. I got the second time at the new gym at High Point. The Cubain Center, which is fabulously over the top almost. And
you got to come to Gonzaga with me next year. I know. Why didn't we do it? I was out there this year.
I was just telling Gary, you know, he's asking me about where I haven't been. I said, I've really gotten most of the iconic places. The one great iconic place that I don't have is Oklahoma State, the IBA, the Gallagher IBA.
Yeah.
I still want to go there. Okay. But Gonzaga, you've sold me on.
Have you been to Lubbock? Have you ever been to Lubbock?
No.
I may go this weekend. Texas, Chris Beard goes back to Texas Tech. It's going to be one of the best/worst environments you've ever seen because they despise him. When you leave Texas Tech to go to Texas, I mean, they absolutely hate him, even though he took him to a national title game. But it's an NBA pod.
Ryan and Jeff Goodman make a road trip, you have to document it. You got to make it into a Snapchat or a.
Yeah, no, we will. Well, I don't know how to do Snapchat, and I know Bob. We'll leave the Snapchatting to Bob.
My 10-year-old will put it together for you. How about that?
Coach Belichick would call it Snapface.
Snapface, exactly. I want to start with Chicago because now they have the injuries, and then this is going to dovetail into what Jeff wants to talk about with Grayson Allen. Here you have the Chicago Bulls, Bob. Terrific chemistry, terrific story this year. And then they have two injuries, Caruso, who is your guy, and also Ball is going to have surgery. Can they survive the injury?
That's my guy. That's my guy.
Caruso's your guy. Oh,
No.
I like
Ball. Lonzo.
I'm a Caruso guy. But he's a Ball family guy. You know, we all know that. The answer probably is going to be very difficult. It's going to be the answer is more than likely no. It's going to be very difficult. I just don't know where they're going to, you know, find the replacement. I mean, losing Ball was bad enough, but then losing Caruso on top of that, I mean, Caruso would have been helped fill the void a little bit. It's a bad week for the Bulls. And I feel badly about it because I like that they're a likable team and they've done a nice job of putting something nice together and they've been playing well. I wish them well, but I fear for them.
Yeah, I think they're in trouble. Like, you know, to me, again, I think the Bulls played over their head early, and DeRozan's been so darn good and an MVP candidate. And now, you know, you got without Lonzo for the next month or two, he'll come back. I don't know if they're going to have that same mojo, you know. And I thought they caught the Eastern Conference at the right time, right? Embiid doesn't have Ben Simmons. The Celtics are struggling. The Hawks struggled. The Knicks kind of went back to the Knicks, you know? So like somebody had to take advantage And Brooklyn didn't have Kyrie.
Yeah, right. You're right.
So somebody had to take advantage, and I thought Chicago did it. And Billy Donovan's national, he's coach of the year to me at this point with what he's done. And DeRozan's been fantastic. I just don't know if they're going to be able to keep it up.
So, Jeff, you wanted to talk about the Grayson Allen foul resulted in a one-game suspension. And Caruso going to the hoop, Allen goes up, fouls him. Yeah. To me, it didn't look that bad. I was surprised it resulted in a wrist injury that is putting Caruso out for like 6 weeks. And he gets
but he hit him hard in the air. You can't do that, especially if you're Grayson Allen. And I know this has been Grayson. Listen, nobody knows it better. I sat down with Grayson Allen for an exclusive for ESPN after I think it was his second or third tripping incident. He had won at Louisville, one against Florida State. And I don't think when I sat down with him, I just don't think he knows how to control how he plays the game. I think he's always played the game this way, which is, at 100 miles an hour, going hard. And I think it is, if you take that away from him, is he even an NBA player? If you change that mindset, do you then not go hard all the time? And you're not really a guy who sticks in the NBA. So I think it got him there. So he's thinking in his mind, I need to play this way in order to stick in the league. But man, over and over and over. And that's the problem, is you got this pattern of tripping, of now again, hitting a guy in midair when everybody knows Kelly Oubre did it last night too, to somebody. I forget who it was and what it was, but you just got to be careful. LeBron did it. LeBron did it the other night to somebody in the air.
In general terms here, I'm not buying it in terms of he has to play this way to stay in the league kind of thing. Because it's a differentiation. We're talking about different things. Marcus Smart plays hard. We all agree to that. Has he ever once been accused of being dirty? Not that I know of.
He just flops. He just flops.
Yeah, all right. That's don't do it. He's lucky he doesn't play when Dave Cowens is playing. I'll just tell you that. But that's another story for another day. But no, he plays hard, and there are other guys who we can identify who play hard and but never been accused of being dirty. There's something I don't know how Grayson Allen is wired. That whole thing in college, it made zero sense to me. Zero, no sense to me whatsoever, and. This is it's been a while since we heard from him, in terms of he's been clean. His slate's been, I guess it's been clean. Right. And it just so happens it's Grayson Allen, whoever did this, it was a bad thing though. It was, I think it was a very treacherous thing for him to do.
So you don't think it was a reputation thing? Whoever made that foul was getting a game.
Yeah. Well, that's a very good question. I don't know for sure, but I think it's odds are yes. I think the odds are, but it's not, I can't guarantee
if that it was a reputation thing. He would have got more than a game. See, I felt like, again, and they shouldn't, like nothing he did in college could have any effect on what you're doing to him in the NBA. He wasn't a repeat offender or anything like that. Like college, different situation completely. But again, you just look at it and at some point, is somebody just going to go after him in the NBA and just pop him next time he does this stuff? Because it's just been over and over, and he has that reputation, and he's kind of that guy that at Duke, he was like the next J.J. Redick in terms of the guy that everybody loved to hate, right? It was Leitner, Redick, and then it's always kind of the white guy at Duke, but I don't think there had been one at that level until Grayson started tripping dudes left and right.
Yeah, right. No, it's an unusual phenomenon, this whole – the whole Dookie thing anyway, starting with Lakener. He's actually been good, though.
As an NBA player, he's actually been a solid NBA, probably better than I thought he'd be in the league.
Hey, listen, our first exposure, everybody's first exposure to him, of course, was that NCAA final game, when he absolutely, for most of us, came out of nowhere to win that game.
Nowhere.
Win a championship for that.
Everybody.
Then he became Mr. The notorious Grayson Allen, the night tripper and day tripper. He was day tripper, night tripper, weekend tripper. He was all kinds of tripper. And all right, I had to do that. And but it look, the act, it's, there's no defense for what he, for that, no matter who did it. Okay. And it's, if one of the interesting things about sports always, when something like that happens, because it really pertains to hockey more than anything, which is, how biblical do you want to get with the punishment? In other words, eye for an eye. If I'm out 5 games, you got to be out 5 games. In this case, it's going to be 6 weeks maybe versus 1 game. It doesn't seem quite fair somehow, you know, that's the case.
I mean, now the Bulls lost Patrick Williams early in the year, right? Maybe even the preseason, but right early in the year, and he was a starter. Then you're without Lonzo, and now you're without Caruso. That's three of your top eight guys or so.
It's going to be awful hard to overcome.
Yeah, I mean, if they can do it, wow. But, you know, at this point, if you're the Bulls, you're playing for matchup as much as anything and playing to get healthy when it matters most in the playoffs. But, you know, who do you want to stay away from? I guess in the second round, does it matter if you play Brooklyn or Milwaukee? I mean, it's probably about the same, right?
Depends on where you're playing Brooklyn. Right. You want to play Brooklyn on the
good
road.
Point.
You
don't want to good
play
point.
Him at home. that's going to be one. Oh, this is going to be one. I almost can't wait till we get to that point in the season to what we're going to be saying and watching and talking about and how that's going to play out with them in the playoffs. Right.
Oh, my God. Kyrie is going to love it. Kyrie is going to eat it up.
Yeah. Speaking of which, he had 30 last night. And by the way, all right, now let's get to another indefensible act of much more bizarre. And that's David Vanterpool, the assistant coach of the Brooklyn Nets, who was $10,000 poorer as we speak by doing something that most of us have never seen, which is a coach intercepting a pass off the bench in the middle and with 5 minutes and 43 seconds left in the fourth quarter of a 6-point game. David Vanterpool cannot restrain himself as a pass is being made. The pass, just for the specifics here, it was Dinwiddie to Kuzma, but it was deflected by David Vanterpool, and the referees didn't get it, didn't see it, which leads us to something else that's one of my crusades of longstanding, guys, which is Kuzma, I thought very rationally, was talking about what the reason the refs didn't see it is that Steve Nash was standing in the way of their eyesight on the play. And it brings to something I've been saying for 30 years. Coaches should not be allowed to leave the bench, except maybe to call timeout. No standing, period. Sit your ass down. At every level. I mean this. I'm very serious.
Bob,
I've been saying this for 30 years. Coaches should be made to sit their ass down. Period.
Good luck with that. I mean, good luck.
Listen, make them do it. Good luck.
In the NBA,
make them do it.
Actually, in the NBA, it's way better than it is in college. Bob, it's insane in college. These coaches don't shut the hell up, and they are up entire game. I mean, John Calipari is up almost the – Bruce Pearl is up almost the entire game, and they don't shut up to the refs. So it's like when the refs don't make a call, you can't blame them. These guys are yelling and chirping at them the whole frigging game. And with NBA, actually, it's way worse with the players than it is. Some of the coaches are bad, but like they're not up nearly as much as the college guys.
Well, but I agree with you. I totally agree with everything you're saying. But this is something nobody ever talks about. And I've one of my little obsessions, I've told you literally for 30 years, for maybe even 40 years, is coaches, you know, should not
be. Yeah, but you know what? Coaches, number one, it's never going to happen because coaches will get less endorsements sitting on the bench. So that's the big problem right there. It's not good for the brand, Bob. It's not good for the brand. A brand that's hurting this year has been the LA Lakers. Right. As we speak, they're a game under 500. They've moved up into eighth place in the West. You can't fire the players. And as we know, Antonio Davis has not worked out. So, Bob, Frankie Vogel, our former audio sound man of the Boston Celtics 100 years ago, is he going to get the whack? Is he going to get the axe, I should say?
It's very possible. But, you know, the problem starts here with general manager James and the team he and his assistant Palenka put together, you know. And that's the issue. But he will. I think it's a fairly good chance he'll be the scapegoat sooner or later. Yeah, probably. But it's not going to solve anything.
Well, that's the thing is who you, I mean, all you're going to want to do, right? They've acquiesced to LeBron for whatever it is, right? Whatever he wants, he gets. And the moment he decides that he doesn't want Frank Vogel around anymore, they'll make a move. They'll bring in another, not another buddy, because I don't think Frank Vogel was like LeBron's buddy or anything, but I think he knew Vogel well enough and he knew his reputation that Vogel would be easy to deal with, would go along with most. And if you're Frank Vogel, you're out of a job, right? You're saying like, whatever, if I got a chance to win the title, I'll go and play the game with LeBron. It doesn't matter. And if I can get, you know, 3 years, that's probably a good run. 3 years with all the money Frank Vogel's made and you know, gets an opportunity, you know, to coach LeBron and have a chance, if everything goes right, to win titles every year. Obviously, this year it's different. You got AD who's been hurt. I don't know if he wanted, you know, to me, the problem was Russ. He just didn't fit. He didn't. Right. If you're going to bring in a third guy, it shouldn't have been Russell Westbrook.
Well, you know, when it gets down to where he is sitting on the bench for the last 4 minutes of a close game because the coach says, I had to put out the team that had the best chance to win the game.
He doesn't guard at all. Like, that's what people don't get. Like, he puts all this effort and intensity into the offensive end of the game. And end of the floor, but the dude doesn't guard at all. Like, his man could be all the way on the other side of the court. He has no idea half the time. So if you really want to win that bad, at some point, don't you say, I'm a freak athlete. I can guard. I can guard probably anybody I want if I put my mind to it. But there's been no pride in that end of the floor for Russ forever now.
No, it's
well, isn't the problem with the Lakers, Anthony Davis hasn't been healthy since day one.
Yeah, you add Anthony Davis, they're instead of being 500, they're 10 games over 500. Honestly, a healthy Anthony Davis makes that much of a difference with the Lakers.
Yeah, that's right. But
anyway. And we're not complaining. We're not talking about Frank Vogel's job being on the line or any of that. Maybe they're not the number one seed, but they're in that top three or four discussion. And nobody cares because everybody's just saying, hey, they need to turn it on. So to me, if they can get in, you know, the only problem is you get in at that point, you haven't played together all year. And again, you still got that Russ issue where he doesn't fit in with LeBron and AD.
You know, you talk about Russ, I think the whole triple-double thing took on a life of its own. Right. It was, you know, and became his entire identity in his mind, I'm sure, you know. And you know, so we all love the fact that it was a big ballyhoo a couple of weeks ago when he finally had a game after 400 plus games of we didn't have a turnover. And that was news. I'll ever remember all the years I've watched and covered the league. I'll ever remember that ever becoming such an issue with anybody. Yeah. 400 games and without a turnover. But before he finally had one.
Well, you talk about the Lakers lacking chemistry. And I think one thing that we've seen this year has been the chemistry of Cleveland, the chemistry of Chicago. I think you could say that probably Phoenix has chemistry. Obviously, Golden State does, but that's I don't even have to mention that. But you take a look at chemistry right now with Cleveland, and that made me, I want to ask this question. I think this is right in Bob's wheelhouse. Bob, we talked about Cleveland last week. What is the best chemistry in a team that you've ever seen in the NBA? And you don't have to, I'm going to go for a season. Okay. For a season.
It may very well. Well, the first thing that came to mind when I was the 70 Knicks, 69, 70 Knicks. And that worked beautifully at both ends of the floor. They moved the ball as well as any half court team, you know, to that point in history, quite frankly. And set a standard that's only been approached occasionally in the ensuing, believe it or not, 50 plus years. And that worked. They had it. The 86 Celtics certainly had it. I mean, what they had, particularly from the middle, they had a 2 month period where it was absurd that they were so good. It was like they were playing a different sport than what everybody else was playing for the most part. Where they were so good, it coincided with, you know, with Walton completely fitting in the middle of January night. They beat the Lakers and Walton started off by blocking a Kareem shot and the crowd came out of its mind right then and there. And anyway, they had it for the most part. And the Trailblazers that one of the great what ifs in NBA history, how much they could have accomplished after that first championship in 77. They were 50-10 in 1977-78 on their way, prohibitive favorites to win another one. Walton got hurt. And then by the end, they were all, but four fifths of the starting five, I think, was injured by the playoffs. That we'll never know. They had it. And that's Dr. Jack's team had it. There's three. Recently, you got to go with the Warriors. You got to go with what they've done. The Warriors they're at their best over the last this run, which is now half a dozen years or more. And they got it back again this year. They have to have Draymond Green out there, to have it all work perfectly. But they're in the discussion.
How good were the Lakers teams in terms of chemistry? The teams with Magic and Worthy.
Yeah. I don't know what it's like them. I always say the best series that never was the 86 Celtics against the 87 Lakers. That would have been, oh my God. Once they picked up Michael Thompson and they were whole. And then they had it. Yeah, I think we'll find examples of other teams. People say, what about the Bulls? They won all those championships. To me, the Bulls are the odd man out only because it was all about Michael. It was always all about Michael. It was not about team. It was always all about Michael, and which is a tribute to him. Frankly, how great he was. Let's not ever forget how great he was. And in all these greatest GOAT discussions, but it was still all about him. You didn't think about the team as much as thought about Michael. But
yeah, I always thought the 04 Pistons. Remember that? They came out of nowhere.
Yeah, it did come out.
Season, Rasheed Wallace was a team guy.
Well, that was the. He was a pickup.
Yes, I know.
And they needed it. And he's one of the more frustrating individuals in the history of the league. He should have been punching a first ballot ticket to the Hall of Fame. And he just
so talented.
And he just didn't do what he should have done often enough, except set out standard for technical fouls.
Less. Hey, he just left Memphis. He was on their staff, with Penny Hardaway and Larry Brown. And Rasheed left because he wouldn't get vaccinated. So that was it.
Memphis is a team I forgot to mention with chemistry. It just seems like, and of course on CLNS, you can watch our Celtics pod too. But when I go through it, I was looking at the chemistry and Jeff and I were talking about Cleveland. Like I said, Cleveland and Memphis last week, and you guys are both fans of them. And I started to think, if Tatum and Brown had what Ja Morant has in Memphis, or what Lonzo Ball, or Levine, who's coming back for Cleveland, had in Cleveland, what a different story that would be. Because the point is that you have Michael, and he's probably the exception to the rule. But other than that, all the other great championship teams had that chemistry. Aside from the star, and right now you have two Celtics stars and nothing else works. And if you took what Memphis has or Cleveland has or Chicago has and put it with Brown and Tatum, it might be a different story, Jeff.
Yeah, I'm just kind of looking at the teams ahead of them in the standings. And you're saying like, all right, Miami's got the culture and the talent. Brooklyn's got the talent. We know that. The Bulls had a elite level pass first point guard. The Bucks have a superstar who's just as much of a not about himself as there is in a really good point guard in Drew Holiday. Those are your top four teams right now in the East. Charlotte's ahead of the Celtics right now. They got a kid who can pass the hell out of the ball, right? Like he just makes everybody better in LaMelo. The two outliers ahead of them, Cleveland to me, the fact that Cleveland is ahead of the Celtics right now is a complete and utter embarrassment if you're a Boston Celtics fan or player. The fact that you can look down that roster and say they are 28-19 and we're 24-24 is a complete joke, because the Celtics, as we've mentioned, have two all-star caliber players. Jayson Tatum went for 51 last night. Cleveland's got a bunch of like decent players. Most general fans of the NBA probably can't name a player on the Cavs right now.
Yeah, you're right. Garland would maybe that after that. You're right. So something very good there is going on in that regard. There's no doubt. You can't argue with that.
So, but, you know, we talk about the stars in the league. And I just see, and there's no question that there are the stars. But one of the things that I'm observing in this league, I think there's kind of a shift right now where I don't
you
know.
You need a star. You still need a star to win
you
the
still,
whole
you, No, 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 no. You need the star, Jeff. Yeah. But I don't know if there's a person out there that can win a championship on their own the way Michael did.
No,
I thought LeBron was that guy. I thought LeBron was that guy, but I don't see anybody else. I don't even think the Freak can do it.
He can. I mean, he's got good complementary pieces that are actually better than we thought in Chris Middleton and Drew Holiday. And they've got really good role players that are a whole hell of a lot better than, again, when you look down, I hate to go back to the Celtics, but
well, that's
the Celtics complementary pieces. They're you know, Pat Connaughton, you take him on the Celtics any day of the week right now. Right? Right. I mean, he'd be great for the Celtics.
I mean, the Celtics have always had a Caruso. They don't have one. You know what I mean? They don't. The good Celtics teams always have
James Posey, right? Even right. A James Posey.
They don't have
a great one for that.
They don't have one. You know? Wesman, go down the list. Gentlemen, it's always a pleasure. Bob, welcome back from Transy.
Thank you.
And I was just very happy to know that Bob had not only been to the University of Maine, Pitt, not once, Jeff Goodman, but twice. Twice.
That's a haul. That is a haul.
You know what it's going to say on Bob Ryan's gravestone? I don't want to be dark here. Gym rat.
Yes.
Gym rat.
203, but we got to get you next year when hopefully everything's a little bit easier to travel for us. Bob, we have to, in the preseason, set something for either. Shoot, we could do 4 days and hit Stillwater on the way to Spokane.
That's a reality show. That Goodman and Ryan, that is a reality show. Planes, Trains, Automobiles, and Gymnasiums. Okay, guys, see you later.